In short, it was...
Hi friends, it's Andriy Vasilenko, and welcome to Metallic Geek. It happened! SNM 2, the movie, some of you may have been disappointed with it. We had set too high expectations, we needed Orion, we needed Fixer, but we got what we got, and it turned out to be freaking amazing. Some of you in the comments said that it totally beats SNM 1. It was more pure by being less clean. And let me explain it. What they did flawlessly, what they did not so good. Get comfy and enjoy the discussion. The first act appears to be the first part of the first show, and the second act, according to Lars, he said that in the movie, the second part of the second show. You can feel it, hear it, and see it. You know, the first part was, you can feel this tension, these nerves, like they are playing for an exam. They knew they should not screw up, so they played it as accurate as possible. And the second part was more loose. They felt more freely on stage. They felt like they are on a regular show. And these peculiar characters of these two acts made this show so balanced and so sincere. And also the first part turned out to be more heavy, with the more distortion than clean parts. And the second act was more melodic, more calm. The Day That Never Comes and Wherever I May Roam come to my mind first. The Day was the tightness and precision and concentration. And Wherever I May Roam was something less of a tension, but more like they just hanging out and play with friends. And they also represented two eras of Metallica albums where tightness was everything. And Justice for All, first of all. Master of Puppets, Ride the Lightning, also Death Magnetic and Hardwired. And albums with a live performance vibe. First of all, Load Reload, also Saint Anger and the Black Album. By the way, this was the first Metallica show ever that features songs from every album. Even though James did look much fresher on the second show, his voice, though, was more exhausted. Perhaps because he gave his best shot on the first show, and the 2 or 3 days was not enough to recuperate completely. And yeah, the most important thing, probably, there was no auto-tune. On the 1999 release, they did so much pitch correction to make it as polished as possible for the official DVD. But James does not need it. We want to hear James and not the robot. He's a great singer. We don't need any perfection there. Because this is f***ing rock. Speaking of things that suck about S&M is the cameraman work on the first two songs. Cthulhu and From the Battles. The only two compositions, except Anesthesia, that was obvious, where bassist must have more close-ups than guitar player. Especially considering that the first Cthulhu in 1999 was played with a pick, and those were not the parts that Cliff composed. Jason did something on his own. But this time, Robert did what Cliff would have done, with fingers, with wah, and all their mini solos. And yet, no single close-up on Robert on Cthulhu. I don't know why. They should have been consulted about it. That was probably the most disappointing thing in S&M 2. Of course, without Michael Kamen, I cannot say that S&M 2 beats S&M 1 completely. I cannot imagine how much was on the shoulders of Michael Kamen in preparation to S&M 1. He was such a hero who allowed this to happen. But still, Michael Tilson Thomas and the younger conductor, they did a great work. But still, especially on Moss Into Flame, I lacked something fresh on top of guitars, some interesting counterpoint, and not just doubling what guitar does and just doing the same accents. Listen to Michael Kamen's orchestration. He complemented the Metallica music with new melodies, and all those parts, those layers, did fit like a puzzle. So in Moss Into Flame, there was a big chunk of the song that I basically did not hear anything from the orchestra. And for a moment I forgot that this is Diss and Dem actually. So Metallica playing their usual song on the usual gig. But that was the only exception, Moth Into Flame, a song that I felt like they could have done better. But again, I have to listen to it not in the theater, because, you know, the cinema is not supposed to provide a good sound for a metal show. You can imagine how messy that sound turned out to be in the cinema. Alright, let's go through every song. The Day That Never Comes turned out to be one of the highlights of the show. First of all, it was a brand new symphonic arrangement of a Metallica song. Such a great song it is. This is the ultimate Metallica ballad. It has something from every Metallica ballad from before. From Fade to Black, from One, from Welcome Home, from The Unforgiven. Confusion. A surprising pick, because it's the weakest song on the Hardwired album. But it did sound amazing on live performances. And with Symphony Orchestra, it worked out too. And how could it not? Every song would work out with Symphony Orchestra. The Outlaw Tour, in my top 3 on the show. I cannot express what I felt when I heard that first scratch with wah. Wah! James got another chance to play his solo, and I'm really glad to hear it. No Leaf Clover. I cannot say much about it. They repeated it and that sounded great, but I cannot recall anything special what I saw and heard there. Hail on Fire, another song from Hardwired. Again, I cannot recall any outstanding symphonic parts there, but I do recall that I thought that it's a song with such a great potential, and yet they just merge 4 separate parts into one song. Like in Fade to Black, in One we have these smooth transitions between different riffs. In Halo and Fire, just bricks glued together. Though the first and last parts are the best. They should have made it shorter. And now the Act 2. So many surprises. They began this part with 2 pieces. The first one was Sergei Prokofiev's piece, and the second one was Alexander Molosov's piece. The Prokofiev's piece was, well, a lot of people in cinema went to the toilet in that moment, and actually they did not miss much. But when the Iron Foundry, or Zavod by Molosov, started, If I Didn't You, it's written in 1920s in Soviet Union, I would think that it's a legit metal song. It has a riff, and the composer did experiment with this ostinato stuff that was pure metal, and that'd be awesome if they included it in Harage Inc. 2. Then The Unforgiven 3. I did expect it to be in the S&M 2, but I did not foresee it going this way. Just the orchestra and James. When I saw the clip on YouTube for the first time, I thought that how powerful it would have sounded with the whole band. But then I thought, that's genius. They just stripped it down. And that was a really fresh note on the S&M 2. Something that we didn't hear in 1999. Again, James sounded a bit strained. And sometimes you could see James not knowing what to do with his hands. All Within My Hands. I hope that something from Saint Anger would be on this concert. And I kinda forgot about this version of All Within My Hands. I really like how Robert Bass sounded in this one. And then Anesthesia Pulling Teeth. Huh. Of course, that was one of the best tributes to Cliff Burton ever. Alright, I saw only 3 clips on YouTube before watching the movie. It was Anesthesia, No Leaf Clover, and The Unforgiven. The rest was like, I want to retain it for the cinema experience. And what I saw in the Anesthesia clip for September 6th, I liked more. The guy, his name is Scott Pingel, or Pingel, sorry. That was the first time he did it, and that was a huge tension. And he may have been more confident on the second show, what we see in the movie, his second take. He didn't knew what it would turn out, but on the second show he knew it's gonna work. But still, Scott, you're amazing. Thanks for such a tribute. That's something Cliff would have done himself, I believe.
And that was wherever I may roam. For some reason, seeing Kirk behind that sitar cracked me up. I don't know why. But again, there was something in this performance that made it really stand out. And I don't get what exactly. Yeah, they did look like they're just hanging out. They finally confident the show is going to end. And they did it almost perfectly. Maybe you can say what is so special in that Wherever I May Roam performance. I'm not gonna pronounce it again. And then followed four songs that were great, but I cannot say anything very special about it. But one thing I can say about one is that they did try to make it tight, tighter than usual. Lars tried to articulate every that triplet beat, but again, when the solo started, they got back to the simplified version. My voice is tired from just talking about it. My throat has started soaring. Just imagine what James has gone through on these concerts. Thanks to Metallica for such a gift. They are such professionals. They still got it. And share your thoughts in the comments. What do you think? Are you pleased? Are you pissed? I'm definitely pleased. And my wife too. Thank you all and hear you next time, friends. Пиздец охуенно.